Thank you very much indeed. This is actually a joint piece of work between Jane, Professor Michael Marsh from Trinity College. Jane, we've recently lost Dr. Jane Suter to Dublin City University, so we were very disappointed about that. And nobody may tell Michael, but we couldn't persuade him out of the pale for the evening, so he remained in Dublin. So what I'm going to... I'm actually going to echo much of what has already been said in relation to the Oireachtas Inquiries referendum. I'm going to take us through referendum voting in Ireland, so the actual outcomes of the elections themselves. I'll say a little bit about variation in referendum campaigns. Oh, I'm very sorry, I've caused a little bit of discussion about the variation in referendum campaigns themselves, how voters actually make up their minds, some different ideas or ways we have of understanding the process of decision-making which voters go through. And I'm going to use the Oireachtas Inquiries referendum to illustrate this particular process. So just give me 2 seconds while I get up my props. So as we've already heard, we've quite a lot of experience of referendums in Ireland, and that means that we have a huge amount of data on voting behaviour and the way in which voters make their decisions at referendums. So much of the international research on referendum voting has actually been clustered here, so it gives us quite a lot that we can actually say about voting. What I have here to start with is just a chart. This is using European referendums, but it illustrates an important point about referendums in Ireland, that we have kind of three broad clusters or three groups of voters. You have the red group here at the end, and these are voters that we say have a predisposition towards voting no. They're inclined to vote no, and you'll see that that's a reasonably stable group. It goes up and down a little bit, but there isn't a huge amount of change. In terms of political parties trying to persuade voters to vote in favour of a particular proposal or to get the yes vote out, what we're interested in is the intersection between the grey area and the green area. The green area is yes voters, and the grey area are abstainers. And the case we always use to highlight this particular point is Nice 1, which you can actually see here. And the major reason why the first Nice Treaty didn't go through was because voters who usually vote in favour of European referendums stayed at home. So it's not that the yes or the no vote actually went up to any great extent, and you can see that here. The no vote is relatively flat between Nice 1 and Nice 2. It's that the people who usually vote in favour of the European treaties did not come out. So what we're often very interested, political parties in particular, or groups that want to influence referendum campaigns, they're interested in that line between the grey area and the green area for the most part. How do you persuade people who might otherwise abstain to come out and vote in favour or against your particular proposal? So in terms of how voters decide, we have a couple of different constructs that we use to understand what is going on in their minds and their heads when they're coming to their decision. When we think about referendums, there's actually a variety of different types of referendum questions that are put before the public. And the nature of the question is very important in terms of how people arrive at the decision and what factors are influential in determining the final outcome of that referendum. And we have a continuum here where we have a group of stable referendums on one end and volatile referendums on the other end. And there are a whole series of factors that contribute to whether something is a stable referendum or a volatile referendum. If we begin with the stable ones, these are ones where questions are asked of the electorate, but that draw on some sort of deep inherent values that people have, fundamental views they have about the political system, the nature of society, the nature of politics. So you're drawing on values that only change very slowly and often over decades. So we're talking about the inherent features of Irish political culture, how they change, how they evolve. So if you're asking somebody a question that draws on these types of issues, it's likely that you're going to have a very stable referendum. People are going to enter the campaign with a particular set of views, and it's going to be hard to make them or to persuade them to change their minds. On the other end of the scale, we have volatile referendums, and these are ones we argue that they tend to deal with political issues that are relatively new. Questions about something that the voters don't spend a lot of time thinking about, and that they don't really want to spend a lot of time thinking about. So we might say here Oireachtas inquiries would fall into this category, and lots of ones about institutional design and reform, where the voters don't hold very strong views on how the system should operate. And these will be subject to quite a lot of variation. People don't have predisposed views, so the campaign matters a lot. The actions, the information, and the way in which people acquire their information in the course of the campaign will matter an awful lot in these types of campaigns. And then we have this kind of cluster in the middle that are influenced by things like political parties, the leaders of parties, and groups from outside the political system. And a lot of the evidence that we have on voting at referendums tells us that people like to hear from groups outside of the party system. So they want to hear from kind of what we might call third pillar. They want to hear from their trade unions, from their churches, from the community and voluntary groups. They're very interested, and they can influence in both directions. We have another factor here that kind of floats around quite a bit, what we call a second order effect. So the state of the economy can influence, but it doesn't influence in exactly the same way in every election. So for example, the spectre of the IMF was already at the door at Lisbon too, yet the government managed to get it through. So the performance of the economy is in there, but it will vary a little bit. And just to put some referendums on the spectrum, we would argue that children's rights is somewhere on the stable end of the spectrum. People have deeply held views about this, and it's likely that the campaign will be quite stable. The fiscal compact treaty is one. European treaties are becoming more volatile. But that being said, there is a long history of European referendums. Many people who are going to the polls have voted in these before. The arguments have been rehearsed. So you're not coming from a low information or a zero information base. There is some information, and some voters, of course, will have a predisposition either way. And we would finally put in Shannon abolition, for example, to look a little bit into the future. This is likely to be quite volatile. People probably don't have very strong views on upper houses of parliament. They may have on extra politicians in the system, but if the argument goes towards an upper house of parliament, whether we should have it or not, it's likely that the campaign will matter a great deal, because people will be acquiring new information for the first time, and their opinions will be forming in the course of the campaign. So the campaign will matter depending on whether you want to vote yes or vote no. One of the other things that we kind of look at is how do voters actually make their mind up, and this is a little bit of what we call voting calculus. So we'll just start here. SQ is the status quo. So that's where you are the voter. You're at the status quo and you're asked to make a change. The change could be either X1 or X2, and it will depend on the wording of the proposal where the change will take you to. I might be your ideal point. That might be what you personally would like to see happening. So in some referendums, you're deciding whether you want to move to X1 or X2. Both of them are beyond your preferred set of circumstances. So the campaign will matter in terms of the decision you come to. The other point we want to make from this is that it may be entirely rational to vote no if the status quo remains the same. It is rational to vote no when the status quo remains entirely in the same point. So if you're moving beyond what your ideal point is, even though it's going in the same direction as what you might want, sometimes it's too far, and then you decide you're actually going to stick with where you are. The problem is you have a whole series of elections, referendums, where the status quo is not possible after the referendum. And the most recent fiscal treaty is one of those where a lot of the debate was that the status quo would move. And it was all surrounding this argument about whether we would or we wouldn't have access to extra cash from Germany after the referendum. And in that case, the status quo was going to move in another direction. So then you had a whole new range of decisions to make, which was calculating the difference from the new status quo to your ideal point, to the positions that were being advanced by the wordings on the ballot paper. In terms of international evidence, the main point we just want to get across is that it's quite normal across the world that we see referendum proposals going before the electorate. Initially, they have very high levels of support, but that support can be eroded quite strongly in the course of the election. And we have lots of experience from past elections, past referendums in Ireland, where the Irish electorate choose to vote no when most of the cues they're getting from the political system are telling them to vote yes. And those are the ones that we're, I suppose, particularly interested in, because they seem to go against the direction of politics. And where do we go to find explanations for these? We look at things, particularly at campaigns, particularly short campaigns, ones that are tightly compacted, where the voters don't have a lot of information and where there are low levels of trust. So you can kind of see where I'm going with the Oireachtas Inquiries referendum here. In terms of campaigns, dynamics themselves, just to say just a few words about campaigns and how do they work. When we talk about campaigns, generally speaking, we're thinking about there are two sets of groups that operate in the campaign. You have the political parties who will be advocating in different directions, and you will have civil society groups. And both are very influential, particularly civil society groups in referendums. And they both have a role in explaining and informing the public. So campaigns are about informing, educating and mobilising the public. So this is what they're all supposed to be doing. We have two different mechanisms, are direct and indirect campaigning. In terms of direct campaigning, we talk about the much maligned posters and campaign literature, and whilst they get a huge amount of complaints, one of the things that we found in the Oireachtas Inquiries research is that they do act as cues to alerting voters to the fact that there are upcoming elections. So in the midst of the presidential election, which I can call circus, there was no cues or alerts to voters that there was an upcoming an election. So we might complain about them, but they do have that feature. But the most important element or most important feature of direct campaigning is canvassing. And that's especially, I suppose, valid in Ireland, where there is close contact between the voters and the elected representatives. And it was particularly obvious for its absence at the Oireachtas Inquiries referendum. Indirect campaigning is also very important, but there is a hierarchy in terms of the techniques that come in here. Blogs and social media are probably at the bottom of the indirect ladder. Newspapers are there, but it really is all about national and local radio, and particularly television. It's very influential in terms of the campaign. One of the difficulties we have is that the Referendum Commission doesn't fit neatly into this model of the campaign. It has a central role under legislation, but because of the tight framework and a lot of the difficulties that have just been outlined, what we find is that the Referendum Commission finds it quite difficult to become embedded in the broader campaign. So just to take you kind of through a few quick slides on the Oireachtas Inquiries referendum specifically, this is the outcome of a research report which the three of us did for the Department of Public Expenditure and Reform, who were somewhat perturbed that the proposal had not gone through. And the major reason for that is because, as we'll show you here, a significant proportion of the electorate actually think that Oireachtas Inquiries are a good thing. So this is, if you look here at this particular table, this tells you that more than 60% of the electorate actually think that Oireachtas Inquiries are a good thing, and that they should be enacted. This is kind of the starting point, but when we go on, we find that 93% of those who voted yes support Oireachtas Inquiries. We won't say anything about the 7% who voted yes, but they confound even political scientists. But the really alarming part is that 58% favoured Oireachtas Inquiries, but voted no. So this is where we're really interested in. How do you actually explain people who favour a particular proposal but then vote against it? So this is the kind of major question that we were seeking to ask. And there are kind of three reasons that we came up with. One was that it was too big a change, so going back to our status quo graph. Too much uncertainty, which ties into what we've heard about the campaign and the compacted nature of it and the competition with the presidential election. And then perhaps other features outside of the political system. We do know it was a very volatile campaign, and what this graph shows you is the initial support for the Oireachtas Inquiry's proposal at the start of the campaign and a very rapid pace of its decline as the campaign progressed. In terms of looking at the campaign, we're interested in a couple of things. We're interested in levels of knowledge, so how much do people know, how do they acquire that information, and how useful do they find that information. What's again very strong coming across here is that this is asking people to recall the arguments or the reasons why they voted yes. And in the case of yes voters and no voters, less than 50% of them were able to recall arguments why they voted yes or why they voted no. So this tells us that levels of information were actually relatively low. Post hoc people were not able to tell you why they actually voted they did in the course of the campaign. And we do know from our theory that knowledge and trust are very important framing factors in the decision-making process. Here we have just a few graphs that will tell you about the usefulness of the various sources, and you'll see here the TV and radio discussion is considered to be most useful, and you remember on the hierarchy of campaigning it's up at the top. It's not going to come as any great surprise to anybody. And then there's a kind of a downward direction to the referendum commission ads, which were not seen as terribly useful by the electorate in. But if we look at it the other way around, the next slide we go on, we find the most sources of information in the of the election, and again, it was no great surprise to you that politicians ranked down at the end of the pile. People are not that interested in or don't entirely trust everything that they hear from politicians. As this is a legal audience, you'll be pleased to see that the legal profession do quite well. They are very trusted in terms of communicating information to the public in the course of Oireachtas inquiries. The next one here tells you a little bit about the influence of various sources. So Referendum Commission was highly trusted by the electorate. It wasn't considered terribly useful, and that's probably partly explained already in about the specific nature of the convening of the Referendum Commission. Media coverage, even the voters don't really trust the media, it is very useful in terms of influencing the decisions that they're going to make. We're political scientists, so we can't get away from partisanship and political parties. Obviously, it has a factor, but this is in order. This was actually one of the lesser factors in terms of the overall outcome. So the no vote was strongest amongst those who said they would vote for Fianna Fáil at the next election, and there was a positive correlation with the Fine Gael voters. Somewhat interestingly, a lot of the people who we interviewed who supported Sinn Féin said that they thought the party was actually against the proposal, and that's why they voted no. So this is something that kind of comes out in the quantitative and the qualitative analysis. So low information, low trust, the campaign really does matter. So to go back to our three reasons, they actually hold up relatively well and in the kind of correct, or in the order that we expected. For quite a number of voters, the change was too big, and that's it was a reasonable case, but not all of those who had low knowledge by any means were those who voted against. There were some very informed voters who voted against and were able to recall the arguments why they were opposed to the piece of the proposal that was put before them. In terms of too much uncertainty, this was quite a serious area and came across very strongly. The yes vote would have been higher if the electorate had judged itself to be informed, and we have lots of debates subjective and objective knowledge indicators, but certainly this is in case of subjective knowledge. If the electorate felt they had more information, they would. If they had found some sources of information more useful, if they had higher levels of trust in the referendum commissioner found its information more useful, and particularly that those who favoured the principle and voted no were less likely to feel that they knew enough. The third reason is there, you know, other issues, extraneous second order effects that were unconnected to substantive issue. We have some signs of an anti-government vote, but remember on the same day there was a second referendum that passed easily. So we have these ranked, if you want, in order of their importance and the significance with which they came through in the referendum commission. And I'm just going to say a few words very briefly about the referendum commission, because this did come through quite strongly in the quantitative research we did, but also in the qualitative findings, and especially because we have this dilemma that trust in the referendum commission is actually relatively high, but of course they're very constrained by the way in which they're set up in the legislation which governs their role. And this slide really here just gives you a sense of the spectrum of the regulations governing referendum campaigns across the world. And this is taken from an IDEA 2008 report. And it effectively says that Uruguay has the most unregulated referendum environment, and Ireland has the most tightly regulated referendum environment. And specifically, it questions whether or not this restrains public debate unnecessarily. And it goes into the whole argument about how the role of the Commission has been changed on a number of occasions. And coming out of our work, we kind of came to a number of findings as a separate piece of work that we did, where you can look to other countries for improvements that we could make to free up the debate that we have, particularly around funding allocation. And this is something, it's a role that could be given to the Referendum Commission. Denmark particularly has a structure which is worthy of a further consideration, where they have a funding allocation mechanism where the funds are allocated to both political parties and groups to bring them into the debate, so that we engage more groups in the debate, so that we so that they're financed, so that they can participate effectively within the debate. But they embed their direct democracy structures within the overarching framework of their representative democracy structures. So what they do is 50% of the funding is given to political parties represented in Parliament on a proportional basis, be that yes or no or whatever way they happen to be going, that's how they get the money, and then the remaining 50% is allocated to the groups on the yes and no side on an equal basis. So money is allocated to bring groups into the discussion on either side. Much of these recommendations have actually come through in a number of different reports that have gone to government. They were written by lawyers and political scientists alike, and they are now collecting dust, so I won't go through them. But to conclude, one of our points is that our major point is that the campaign does matter quite a lot. Trust and knowledge are vital. Our referendum rules do need some serious attention, particularly to freeing up the referendum commission. And one of our, I suppose, specific recommendations is that we should look at the idea of putting the referendum commission on a permanent basis, especially if we're embarking on anything up to 10 referendums into the future.